How y'all doing today? Cheryllee back with another video. So I am Cheryllee with everything Cheryllee brand. And so today I just want to bring you another video. So you can find me. You can find me on Instagram. Everything underscore Cheryllee. Everything underscore Cheryllee on Instagram, YouTube, the Cheryl Hubbard Show, and TikTok at all things Cheryllee or at everything Cheryllee. So today I just want to, bring you another video today. So I want to talk a little bit about a number of things, business, business, marketing, advertising, promoting, target markets, marketing channels. So those are the main points that I touched base on in the last video. So in other words, when you're running a business, you try to get everything off the ground. You pick your business name, you did your research, you thought about your marketing niche, you know where your target market is, you know the marketing channels that you want to use. You thought about the competitive advantage, you want to be unique, you did some benchmarking, find out, that's research, more research, find out what other companies are doing. So that is like on the surface. Those things are on the surface, like marketing, advertising, promoting, target markets, marketing channels. So I'm just thinking on the terms of things that you do on the surface to get the business started. But what are the things that you do that you need to do and keep on doing to keep everything running smoothly? So I want to talk about total quality management, continuous improvement, and a number of other terms. So let's get this ball rolling. So let's put a little music on. So like I said, you're running a business, you just starting your business. So you get some marketing. Marketing is more than just selling. Marketing is everything. To me, my opinion, marketing is everything. It's a difference between marketing and a marketplace. So see, a marketplace would be a store or a building, a physical location that you're going to be selling. Or you could be online, or however you want to sell your product. So that's like a marketing place. So marketing is like a verb. So in other words, you have to initiate a product or a service that you want to sell. You want to sell a product, say for instance, you want to sell computers, t-shirts, carpet, whatever you want to sell. But you want to offer a service like cutting hair, permanent hair, whatever type of service. Maybe a law firm or something like that. But that's like a verb, marketing. It's actually doing something. You're finding a product, you're doing research on that product, you're finding out where your customers are, your target market, your marketing channels. You're dealing with the industry in which you're marketing your products in. You are thinking about your competitors, thinking about satisfying your customers, you're thinking about bringing value to those customers. And also, when you think about bringing value to the customers, you want to keep on bringing value to the customers. So you have to have a customer value strategy. So that's a good thing too. So you have business strategy, customer value strategy, your marketing strategy. There are all kinds of strategies that you can implement, I would say, to keep your business flowing. So first, like I said, marketing, advertising, promoting, target markets, and all those are the things in the beginning. But what about the things under the surface? Under the surface that you have to constantly keep on doing to keep things running smoothly in your business. What about total quality management? What about the culture that you create in your organization? Okay, let's talk about total quality management. Total quality management is a people-focused management aiming at continually increasing total system approach in all functions, all departments, and all deals with all employees, and all employees top and bottom. So it means everybody in the organization, all employees, top management, bottom management, all employees, everybody working together to keep all the systems and the departments running smoothly. So they do, you do whatever you have to do to keep those departments and those functions in all those departments running smoothly. So it's total quality. So you want quality in every aspect of your business. So quality is very important. So if you're producing quality in every aspect of your business, then you should be sure to be able to market a quality product, a quality service for your customers. So, okay, total quality management. Then we have the other term that I had with that was, I think it was just quality management. I didn't write it down, I thought I did. So then the other part of that would be, that's total quality management, but you still have quality management. So it's basically similar, quality management. You're managing quality. That's how you're managing your quality in all your processes, in all your functions, in all your departments. You're managing, you're doing, you have to make sure that all the departments are producing quality products, quality services in every department. So total quality management, basically that's just the whole company. Quality management is how you manage it. So that has a lot to do with management. That's management. Management helps to oversee a job like that. Everybody in every department working together, making sure that quality is flowing throughout the whole organization. That's very important. So that will trickle down to your services and your products. So when you want to produce, you definitely want to produce a quality product. And you want to have quality services because you want to be able to keep the customers coming back. Very important. So like I said, these are things that you will continually do. So that's total quality management. So let's go into, let's talk about continuous improvement. So continuous improvement, that means constantly striving to change and make things better. So I would equate that with matching up with TQM, total quality management. Because if you have total quality management throughout all your departments, all your processes, it's basically people oriented. So the people in an organization have to be the one that makes sure that quality is in all departments. And all processes of that organization and quality is flowing throughout the whole organization. Turn the music down a little bit. So continuous improvement. Constantly striving to change and make things better. Right, because if you're running a business, a big business, small business, so you want to continuously improve your processes. I would have tried to improve everything. I mean, I would improve my quality of my products, I would improve my customer service, I would improve my prices. Sometimes I have to check with my prices. I would have to check with my prices to make sure they are appropriate for my customers. But you don't want to charge them high prices too high anyway. And then, other businesses are charging way lower price than you are for the same product. That's going to make you lose customers as well. And also it's good, what I talked about with the early school, I guess they're still doing it in a lot of these organizations. We learned about different teams. So how you can work with teams. You might have a team over here working with this product, and service. Number 10 over here. And then they have something called the ad hoc team. Ad hoc team, a group of people put together to address specific problems. In other words, you might set up an ad hoc team in an organization. You may have a certain problem. What if you have a problem that you're not putting in enough customers in a certain period of time? You might set up an ad hoc team to deal with that problem. You might have another ad hoc team over here, or you might have another team over there. So that's called the ad hoc team. So all these terms go hand in hand with creating customer value. So creating customer value, that is the concept. I guess that's the bottom line of what you're working toward, customer value. So if you have customer value, you still have, you need employees too. You need employees. Employee value, you know? So you can't beat your employees down. I learned too in school. I don't know if they're doing a lot of this in a lot of these organizations, but what I learned is that don't beat your employees down, because the employees are the ones that have first access to customers. Because if your employees beat down, run down, you're not paying them right, the conditions that they are working around or under, poor conditions, pay is low, they get treated bad, that's gonna trickle down to the customer. So you can't treat your employees. Employees are the ones that keep their business going. Well, I know I was doing security, a company I was running for, but I won't name that company, but, and it was just so sad how the owner of the company would come in from time to time and treat some of the employees, some of the security guards, and talk to them like they were trash. And I'm like, these, and I said that, but they didn't know I had a degree in business. But I knew when he did that, I said, that's some of the stuff I learned in school. And that should be implemented for real life. Because I'm saying, how can you talk to your employees like that? They are the ones holding down those posts. Without the security guards, you have no contract. You can lose your contract. Because what if all the security guards walk out and say, look, you're not working under these conditions. You don't like the way owner talks to us. You come in and talk to us like you're trash. Because you're security guard, you're the owner. You talk to us like trash. You know, they never talk to me like that, but I'm saying, I saw it happen firsthand. Talk to them like they trash, and then expect them to hold down those posts, making money for you, when you giving him, you giving the gods a certain portion, but you getting all the damn old money. But I know you would, but your company, but I'm saying, you don't have to talk to your gods back there, you know? Because without security guards, without people holding it down, you can't do all that nothing. That's just like any other business. You open up a business, and you running your business, and you open it up for that particular day, and you don't get what if none of the employees show up? You need somebody to work the cash register. You need somebody to make sure customers are being waited on. So you open your store. What if you open your store on a daily basis, and you already had 10, 15 people, but ain't no none of them show up. None of them showing up, none that week. You ain't gonna make no money. So really, employees are very important to your organization. A lot of times they don't talk about that, but that's what it is. That should be common sense. Because no business is going round and round and round without employees. None. So that was a customer value. So it's important to create customer value in your products and your services. So see, a customer value strategy. A customer value strategy, a business plan for offering value to customers, including product characteristics, attributes, mode of delivery, support services, and I think that's it. Support services, and I didn't write the rest of that. And it says the customer value concept. Customer value concept defines customer value in terms of the combination of benefits enjoyed and sacrifices required of customers. So I said, if customers, I don't know what sacrifice, I guess they would make a sacrifice for us, but it say customer value concept, define customer value in terms of a combination of business and doing the sacrifice required of customers. Customer value concept. So customer value in terms of the combination of benefits. Well, you know, customers will get benefits. When they purchase a product or service, they will get the benefit from that. But what sacrificing the customer, I guess the sacrifice would be probably sometimes they may sacrifice and pay a higher price for something that they may want. Or they may have to go way across town to get something they really want. So they may make a sacrifice in that sense, is what I can think about. In other words, you know, say for instance, you want those particular pair of jeans, but you have a store location downtown that's near you, but they're not selling those particular jeans. It's the same store, but in a different location. So they only have what you want out there in Virginia or somewhere. So, you know, you make a sacrifice to go out there just to get those, you know, particular jeans because you wanted them. You wanted those jeans at that particular price and you want that particular style of jeans. That particular style. So, let me turn that down a little bit more. Make sure it lets you down. Okay, Miss Brandy in the background. So that is customer value. We talk about strategic management. So strategic strategy is just a plan. Management has to have a plan. I guess. I don't know how often they make their plans up because I've never been a manager before, but it would be good to have a manager have a strategic plan. You know, a strategy. It seems like you need a strategy throughout the whole organization. You need a strategy for this, a business strategy, a marketing strategy, a management strategy, whatever, depending on what type of business you're running, it will be determined what type of strategy you need. A strategy is just your plan of action. How are we going to do this? How are we going to do that? What are we going to charge for this? How long is this project going to take? How many employees do we need to fulfill this project, you know? So, talking about total quality management, TQM, continuous improvement. So constantly striving to change and make things better. You always want to strive and make things better in your organizations. Total quality management, ad hoc teams. So total quality should be flowing throughout the organization. Talk about customer value. I talked about this gentleman last. So let's talk about culture. So culture, so how is culture created? How is culture created within an organization? Culture involves behaviors, beliefs, norms, how you treat each other, how people treat each other within the organization. Because you can build an organization and you can build a culture of beliefs and behaviors that can be, I guess the word I want to use, it could be not so good, but I don't know what term I want to use right now, but you can build a, you can create, I would say, you can create organizational culture. I took a course called organizational culture too. So you can build an organizational culture within the organization that is not geared for learning. It's just, you know, disruptive, it's not ethical, and it can become a norm. So you have to be careful when you create culture within your organization, because the culture that you create is basically the environment within the organization. the environment within. So what if you, you're creating a culture where everybody's fussing at each other, people are disrespectful, and then eventually that becomes normal behavior. So it becomes a norm, and that's what you don't want to create. You want a respectable, ethical, morally sound organizational environment, I would say, that's geared for learning. And another course I took, I studied the term organizational learning in one of my courses, Strand University. So organizational learning, you want to build a culture within the organization that's geared for learning, that's geared for growth, geared for empowerment. I don't want to be working for a corporation. So it's been a known fact that some people have left certain organizations because they didn't like what was going on within the organization. You know, they say, you know what, that's not me, I don't think like that, I don't want to part of that, so I'm going to resign. You know, so things like that have happened. So we're talking about total quality management, culture. Culture is the behaviors, social construction, values, beliefs. So what are your values, your goals, your morals, your ethics, values, beliefs, how you treat people, customs, traditions, expectations, understanding. Customs or traditions are the glue that hold an organization together to ensure that members behave according to norms. That's what I was just talking about. So customs are your ordinary actions within an organization. It's customary. It's custom. It's not nothing, you know, you create that's evil, that's bad, you know, it's something that's normal. So I think that was the last term that I was. So then they had a term in the book. So culture, creating a proper culture built on honesty, trust, positive morals and ethics. So then some organizations you go into, they offer those type of training, ethical training. So because sometimes people work together, they can't get along. Sometimes they do have training when you're coming in. You are a new employee. Sometimes they have training sessions throughout the year in some organizations because you're working around certain people. Everybody don't get along. Everybody don't get along at all times, you know. So I talked about total quality management, culture, and TQM and QM. So quality management is similar, but I guess as managers have to make sure that quality is flowing throughout the organization. Quality management, managers have to, you know, make sure they are producing and implementing quality services, products and services. And then I think the last one that I talked about, continuous improvement, customer value strategy, customer value concept. And this is a gentleman, Dr. Walter Schuhart. He worked for Bell Telephone Laboratory during the 1920s. He developed his theory and method for the purpose of interpreting variation in measured characteristics of a series of items produced by a manufacturing process. So he was a gentleman, this was 1920s, it was in a book, my school book. But they sometimes have, different people's name that did, you know, that contributed to whatever that, you know, that course was about. So I got the information from, I'm going to show you the book that I got the information from. This book is called, Total Quality Management, Strand University, Washington, D.C. So I kept all my books so I can review, go back over some stuff. So little drink in the background. So Dr. Walter Shuhart, he worked for Bell's telephone laboratory during the 1920s. So he developed his theory and method for the purpose of interpreting variation in measured characteristics of a series of items produced by a manufacturing process. So I guess his theory was based on manufacturing when you're making products, services, whatever. And his theory, it was in the purpose of interpreting variation and measured characteristics. So probably measure the characteristics, the different characteristics that they had to go through when they was probably making and producing those products. So it's almost like that is like a trend. That would be like a strategy as well. So you can also read more on him, Dr. Walter Shuhart. So also, let's get back into a little bit of marketing. So glad you could join me, glad to see you, glad you could be here. So let me see. Okay, so like I was talking about earlier, I was talking about marketing, advertising, promoting, target markets and all, you know, marketing channels, all those things that you do when you first start your business. Those things I would consider being on the surface when you just start your business, but going deep down in to keep your business flowing, total quality management, continuous improvement. Different terms I was talking about, marketing strategy, marketing management. So marketing in practice. So how is marketing done? So marketing is like a verb, then you have a marketplace. Marketplace is like your storefront, internet environment where you'll be offering your products and services. So you have global markets. Global markets, international markets. And so they have some here, it says Alaska Department of Commerce and Walmart. It says in 2005 alone, China accounted for $337 million of Alaska's exports, from seafood and fish meals to minerals, fertilizers and wood, and surpassed Canada to become Alaska's third largest export partner. So let's talk about Alaska and commerce. Commerce is when you're doing business. It says, noting the huge market potential of China, especially with the 2008 Olympics in Beijing and the 2010 World Expo slated for Shanghai, Walmart purchased about 140,000 Alaska seafood for its China stores. So Walmart, so that's business too. Walmart purchasing seafood from China for their different stores. So that helps them reach global markets. When you, in other words, you're supplying products that you need for certain stores on in your global market. And that was Walmart. And so, and what else they said? Walmart purchased about 140,000 of Alaska seafood for its China stores. So Walmart has stores in China, Walmart has stores everywhere. And matter of fact, I think they just built right here in DC, I think it was eight new ones. I know we have a couple of new ones. They have a couple of new stores near me. I think it's two on this side where I live, and I think it's a couple more on the other side. I think it was eight that they recently put right here in D.C., Washington, D.C. So I order from them online. Sometimes I go directly to the store because they're not too far from me. I order my paint from them and whatever I need, you know, T-shirts, socks, paint, whatever I need, you know. So Walmart supplied their stores, 140,000 Alaska seafood. And then it says, in order to compete with whitefish and farmed salmon from Norway, 5 Walmart stores hired Alaska officials to host cooking demonstrations of wild Alaska sockeye salmon and black cod during a 14-day span. So this was 2005. It says they hired Alaska officials to host cooking demonstrations of wild Alaska sockeye salmon and black cod during a 14-day span. Although they were labor intensive, the demonstrations gave an immediate taste test to China's young, sophisticated urban residents who can pay the high prices these fish command. So, in other words, they put those type of fish in those particular stores. So that, and they were geared toward, I guess, the wealthier people, you know, wealthier customers, because that's what it's saying right here. They said the demonstration gave an immediate taste test to China's young, sophisticated urban residents who can pay the high prices these fish command. So they put those high-priced fish in those particular stores, and they're attracting a certain target market. So it's all about that. Bringing in a certain people, a certain target market. You know, so that was 2005. So let's see, we have marketing in practice. How is marketing done? Increasingly, marketing is not done only by the marketing department. Marketing needs to affect every aspect of the customer experience. You know, marketing needs to affect every aspect of the customer experience, meaning that marketers must properly manage all possible touch points, store layouts, package designs, product functions, employee training, shipping and logistics methods. Marketing must also be heavily involved in key general management activities such as product innovation and new business development. So in other words, marketing reaches all aspects of the business. Training, employee training, product functions, shipping and logistics, packaging design, store layouts. To create a strong marketing organization, marketers must think like executives in other departments. See? And executives in other departments must think more like marketers. We have a later CEO of Walmart.com. It's a CMO and later CEO of Walmart.com, Carter Cass, noted that what surprised him most when he became CMO was that I would interact so much with functions outside of marketing. I didn't realize it is a holistic assignment. Then I realized I really had to understand things like product supply, cost break evens in accounting. Yeah, you got cost break evens, you want to break even. In other words, you're marketing a product and you definitely want to make a product, but sometimes you just break even. So that's what you're saying, break even. You want to make a product, but sometimes you have to lower the price just to break even. And sometimes you might want to, if you're a company and you have those products on the store shelves for too long, and you want to get rid of them, you might have to lower the prices and just break even as opposed to making a profit. So that would be my assumption. Like I said, I've never been a manager before, but just, you know, read up on it in my courses. So, all right, let's see what else they're saying. There are 5 key functions from a CMO in leading marketing within the organization. Strengthening the brands, measuring marketing effectiveness, driving new product development based on customer needs, gathering meaningful customer insights, utilizing new marketing technology. So definitely all of these are very important. So yeah, strengthening your brand, that's definitely important. Measuring marketing effectiveness, so being effective means When you're effective, you're getting things done. Yeah, efficiently means you got it done at a lower cost. So you were effective. You got it done. You marketed that product. You had it at a nice price. You had it at a convenient location. The customer purchased it. So you were effective. So driving new product development based on customer needs, you always want to adhere to the customer needs and the customer wants all the time. So needs and wants and demands. So another term I learned, supply and demand. So sometimes in a business, customers, say for instance you have you're marketing this particular type of t-shirts, and you only had 100 of them. You had 100 of them in your store, but they all sold out. So you may think that, you might say, well, you know what? And then people have been calling the store about them, and people showing up to the store, trying to see if you still had. Yeah, hundreds of people showing up to the store to see if there were any more of those t-shirts left. So that would be, to me, a customer demand. So then I would think that the store will put enough supply out of those particular t-shirts because everybody calling about it. Everybody been running to the store. You know, the store lines are backed up from, you know, maybe one block. And, you know, so supply and demand. So let's see. So we have a core marketing concepts. To understand the marketing function, we need to understand the following core set of concepts. Needs, wants, and demands. Needs are basic human requirements. People need air, food, water, clothing, and shelter to survive. People also have strong needs for recreation, education, and entertainment. These needs become wants when they are directed to specific objects that might satisfy the need. A consumer in the United States needs food, but may want a hamburger, french fries, and a soft drink. Yep, a person in Mauritius needs food, but may want a mango, rice, lentils, and beans. Wants are shaped by our society. Demands are wants for specific products. So you demand for a specific product that you want. You have a need for food, water, and shelter, but you have a need for food, water, and shelter, but you have a demand. The demands are wants for specific products. And I said these distinctions shed light on the frequent criticism that marketers create needs or marketers get people to buy things they don't want. So then you have your target markets, your positioning, and your segmentation. A marketer can rarely satisfy everyone in the market. Not everyone. I don't know what's going on outside. A marketer can rarely satisfy everyone in the market. Not everyone likes the same cereal, hotel room, restaurant, automobile, college, or movie, right? Not everyone likes the same college, the same movie, same hotel room, the same beach, the same t-shirt, the same pair of pants, the same hairstyle. You know, some people wear wigs, some people wear ponytails like me. Some people wear makeup, some people don't. I don't wear makeup, but I wear a little eye. Just a little eyebrow. But some people want makeup, some people don't. Some people want lipstick. Some people want tennis shoes, some people don't. Some people want dress shoes, some people don't. Some people want a truck, some people want a car. So therefore marketers start by dividing the market into segments. They identify and profile distinct groups of buyers who might prefer or require varying product and service mixes by examining demographic, psychographic, and behavioral differences among buyers. Walmart uses segmentation to reach customers in different geographic markets with its new store of the community concept. So this book is kind of old, but it's basically still relevant. Marketing Management. Cotner and Keller, Marketing Management, and this book was, so it says, they identify and profile distinguish of buyers who might prefer or require varying product and service mixes by examining demographic, psychographic, and behavioral differences among buyers. Walmart uses segmentation to reach customers in different geographic markets. So I mean, that would be target. That those are the customers that they would be targeting. That would be considered a target market for those particular stores. It said now over 2 dozen Walmart stores have been designed to reflect the communities in which they are located. So they're in the communities that they are located in. They're doing things that can serve the needs and wants of their customers in that particular community. And that's a good thing. So that's part of their social responsibility as well. Needs and wants of the customers. So like I said, needs and wants. Needs of the customers and wants of the customers. That is what business is about. That is the only way you want to keep these customers coming back. You're not supplying what the customers want, the customers need, they go somewhere else. So right here it says, for instance, there's a Walmart with a Western Flair in Fort Collins, Colorado, and a two-level Art Deco inspired unit to draw in wealthy African Americans in Baldwin Hills, California, in an effort to cater to the country's fourth largest Amish community. So they came into higher income African American target market. So that's why they were supplying certain things in that particular store to draw their target market in. Offerings and brands. Companies address needs by putting forth a value proposition instead of benefits that they offer to customers to satisfy their needs. The intangible value proposition is made physical by an offering, which can be a combination of products, services, information, and experiences. That's what I want to offer on my channel, products, services, information. Yep, so I would say knowledge is powerful, information is powerful as well. Let's talk about a brand. A brand is an offering from a known source. A brand name such as McDonald's is an example I always use. McDonald's carries many associations in people's minds that make up the brand image. Hamburgers, fun, children, fast food, convenience, and golden arches. All companies strive to build a strong, favorable, and unique brand image. Yep. Value and satisfaction. The offering will be successful if it delivers value and satisfaction to the target buyer. See, target buyer. The buyer chooses between different offerings based on which she perceives to deliver the most value. Value reflects the sum of the perceived tangible and intangible benefits and costs to customers. So tangible, something that you could touch. Intangible, you can't touch. So a tangible, maybe like t-shirts, pants, socks, car, or whatever. Intangible products of information that you had to pay for. So say for instance you took a course. You took a course in accounting. That would be an intangible. You can't touch it, but you're still learning. Then we have a supply chain. We have the supply chain is a longer channel stretching from raw materials to components to final products that are carried to final buyers. Then we have a competition, marketing environment. The marketing environment consists of the task environment and the board environment. The task environment includes the actual engage in producing, distributing, and promoting the offering. And also, just want to go over a few of the things in the book. The one that I think that would be more important. We also have production concept, we have a product concept, and we have a selling concept and the marketing concept. So the production concept is one of the oldest concepts in business. It holds that consumers will prefer products that are widely available and inexpensive. So that's the production concept. Then the product concept proposes that consumers favor products that offer the most quality, performance, or innovative features. And we have a selling concept. The selling concept holds that consumers and businesses, if left alone, won't buy enough of the organization's products. So that's the selling concept. And then we had a marketing concept emerged in the 1950s. Instead of a product-centered make-and-sell philosophy, business shifted to a customer-centered sense and respond philosophy. That's a marketing concept. The job is not to find the right customers for your product, but to find the right products for your customers. Find the right products for your customers. That is the marketing concept. So that makes sense. That makes sense because you start a business, you're running a business, you want to find the right products for your customers because you don't just want to operate a business, run a business, and then you're offering products that nobody wants. You definitely won't make no money that way. So that's the marketing concept, finding products that the customer wants. So finding products that the customer wants. So let's talk about holistic marketing. Holistic marketing concept is based on the development, design, and implementation of marketing programs. So they're taking a holistic approach. Processes and activities that recognize their greater and interdependencies. Holistic marketing recognizes that everything matters in marketing and that a broad, integrated perspective is often necessary. So integrated perspective, that means integrate putting everything together. Sometimes you have to have an integrated perspective instead of just having one single idea. But you're integrating all these different ideas, that way you got a different perspective. So let's see what time I'm working with. Okay, 47. Oh, then we have relationship marketing. Let me see what kind of music I can get on. Let me see. Hold tight. So the next one is relationship marketing aims to build mutually satisfying long-term relationships with key constituents in order to earn and retain their business. So relationship marketing, you're building strong relationships with your customers. That's another way to keep your customers coming back. And another thing I was reading up on, when you're running a business, what are some of the things to keep the customer coming back? So like I said, relationship marketing, building long-term relationships with your customers, keep them coming back. Just say, for instance, you're running a barbershop, you're running a hair salon. You want customers to keep coming back. You want them to keep coming back to get their hair cut year after year. You want to put those perms in. You want to braid their hair. You want to do things. Sometimes you want to do things for your customers and offer free services, you know, discounts, free services, free products. And another thing, Starbucks, what they do, well, not only them, a lot of other companies, what they do is, some companies, what they do, they offer free Wi-Fi. They offer free Wi-Fi for their customers. So you come in, you go to Starbucks, you go in there, you want to you know, you buy some coffee or whatever you're driving. Get the free Wi-Fi, you sit there. You sit there and drink your coffee, sit down there and talk, you know, whatever you want to do, if you're on the internet. But, so that's relationship marketing. We have internal marketing, integrated marketing. I talked about before, relationship marketing, we have performance marketing. Okay, let's talk about, what about marketing network? Marketing network consists of a company and its supporting stakeholders, customers, employees, suppliers, distributors, retailers, and agencies, university scientists, and others with whom it has built mutually profitable business relationships. So your marketing network, stockholders, shareholders, employees, customers, suppliers, distributors, retailers, everybody in that marketing network. So they're in that marketing network. Integrated marketing. The marketer's task is to devise marketing activities and assemble fully integrated marketing programs to create, communicate, and deliver value for consumers. Integrated marketing. Integrated marketing. The marketer's task is to devise marketing activities and assemble fully integrated marketing programs to create, communicate, and deliver value. So everything is about delivering value. Delivering value to the customer. Delivering value to the customer, because that is the most important. So you take care of your employees at the same time. You must take care of your employees because they keep the business going around. So employees, take care of your employees, make sure they have everything they need as well. So never forget your employees, but your customers, your consumers, your customers, you want to create value for them. You want to create things, you want to create all these business strategies, marketing strategies, business strategies. Managers have their own strategies. Strategic plans, so strategic plans throughout the whole organization. Total quality management, continuous improvement. Do some benchmarking, go out there and see what other companies are doing so you can do something better. You can offer better prices, lower prices, better services. So benchmark. We also had a marketing mix, product, price, promotion, place. Product variety, quality, design, features, brand name, packaging, sizes, services, warranties, returns. And we have price, list price, discounts, allowances, payment period, credit terms, promotion, sales promotion, advertising, sales force, public relations, direct marketing, place, the places, the marketing channels, coverage, assortments, locations, inventory, and transport. We have internal marketing. Holistic marketing incorporates internal marketing, ensuring that everyone in the organization embraces appropriate marketing principles, especially senior management and marketing principles. So, all right, let's see. Performance marketing. Holistic marketing incorporates performance marketing and understanding the returns to the business from marketing activities and programs, as well as addressing broader concerns and their legal, ethical, social, and environmental effects. Top management is going beyond sales revenue to examine a marketing scorecard and interpret what is happening to market share, customer loss rate, customer satisfaction, product quality, and other measures. So we have financial accountability. Marketers are thus being increasingly asked to justify their investments to senior management in financial and profitability terms, as well as in terms of building the brand and growing the customer base. Then we have social responsibility marketing. There's so many terms in this book. Social responsibility marketing. So that would be dealing with society. Corporations do have a social responsibility to give back to their communities, So that's why I believe they do give away a lot of free products. A lot of organizations give away a lot of free products on a daily basis. So what else do we have? Corporate social responsibility. I took a course too called Corporate Social Responsibility, yep. Capella University. They have cause marketing, promoting social issues through efforts such as sponsorship, licensing agreements, and advertising, cause marketing. So they have a cause. In other words, you got a cause, homelessness or something like that. You know, you create a cause marketing for trying to help the homeless population, trying to help these people over here with this problem over here, that problem. So that would be cause marketing. We have corporate philanthropy. Corporate philanthropy, making gifts of money, goods, or time to help nonprofit organizations, groups, or individuals. Corporate community involvement, providing in kind or volunteer services in the community. Social responsible business practices, adapting and conducting business practices that protect the environment and human and animal rights. Now, I took a course too, also, Australia University, business ethics. So, I mean, that was a good course right there. I think I got a B in that course. Dr. Jewel at Australia University, Washington, D.C. So, we talked about how some companies can be unethical. Well, the book was outlined very nicely. It was set up very nicely. So you read, you know, different types of ethical behaviors that some companies implemented, like chemicals near people's homes, and you know, all kinds of unethical things that some businesses, according to the book, some businesses were, you know, very unethical. Chemicals near people's homes, and then you don't move that, you know, landfills and all that stuff. They had you know, different places like that, different areas of the world that had dangerous chemicals, I would say. And so I guess the book was helping us to see that when you're running a business, ethics is very important. Implementing carrying out proper ethical behavior in your business is very important. That goes along with the other term I was talking about, creating the right culture within your organization. So if you create an organization built on unethical behavior, and you let it keep going on and on and on, you're the manager or CEO or the manager or whoever probably is responsible for overseeing certain operations of the business. You see certain behavior going on in the organization that is unethical, and you keep letting it go on and on and on, and that is how this unethical behavior becomes normal. So that's a lot of stuff we talked about in our class. So it was very enlightening. So you have to nip that in the bud. Any unethical behavior going on in the organization, you have to nip it in the bud so it won't become normal behavior. So your beliefs, your norms, your beliefs, your religion, how you treat people, those are all part of the culture that you create within an organization as you build your strong brand. So you're building a strong brand, you want to do that, but what about building a strong culture? Effective, ethical, morally sound culture within the organization. So, excuse me. Let me just get something to drink for a minute. Oh, this is so good. Yogurt smoothie. And this container right here keeps it so cold. So, almost about to wrap it up now. Okay, let's see. Connecting with the customers, building strong brands. I guess it's a company, developing marketing strategies and plans. So, what your strategies are, just your plans for marketing, your plans for how you want to market this product. How you gonna make this product? Or how you gonna buy it? You wanna outsource it from our own company and then sell it? Or you wanna make it in-house or sell it? How you gonna get it out to your customer? How you gonna reach your target market? Those are all that. Those things should be all part of your marketing strategy. Your marketing strategy, management strategy, marketing strategy, developing marketing strategies and plans. The first task facing is a company right here we're talking about called Atlas. And they say the first task facing Atlas is to identify potential long-run opportunities given its market experience and core competencies. Atlas can design its cameras with better features. It can make a line of video cameras. Or it can use its core competency in optics to design a line of binoculars and telescopes. So, expanding the product line. So they're saying that will be part of their marketing plan, marketing strategy. So, in other words, they're saying that they can have a line of video cameras with different features, cameras with better features, a line of binoculars. So it's like expanding your product line, part of your marketing strategy, your marketing plan. So the company called Atlas, capturing marketing insights. Atlas needs a reliable marketing information system to closely monitor its marketing environment. Its micro environment consists of all the players who affect its ability to produce and sell cameras, suppliers, marketing intermediaries, customers, and competitors. Its macro environment includes demographic, economic, physical, technological, political, legal, and social cultural forces that affect sales and profits. Then you have connecting with customers, and then before I go on, I see it was something I wanted to. They just mentioned something here. Oh, okay, marketing. The company called Atlas, they want to expand their product line. They were talking about the marketing information system. So I was talking, that was my major at Australia University. So one of my degrees is I have a degree in information systems. So every company, every business needs an information system. So marketing information system, I was just talking about accounting. They need an accounting information system, a business information system, marketing information system. I mean, company needs, depending on what kind of company or what kind of business you are running, you definitely need an information system, a system that you have set up to bring in that information. Bring that information in, so that is very important. Information is powerful, knowledge is powerful. You need that information to make those vital decisions within your organization and your corporation. So, it says Atlas needs a reliable marketing information system to closely monitor its marketing environment. So, that I think every business needs an information system. Accounting information system, like I said, Atlas needs a marketing information system. And then we have connecting with customers, building strong brands, shaping the market offerings, delivering value to the customer. I think this is it. Communicating value, creating long-term growth. So, I think I'm going to stop right here because of the lack. The next time I'll touch base on some other things, developing marketing strategies and plans. This is a good book right here. It's definitely a good book. Yeah, the value delivery process. Then it goes on to talk about Nike. So it's a lot of good examples. So when you're reading, they're giving you the definition, they're giving you the information, then they highlight different companies or how they implement the terms that we're talking about. So it says the value delivery process. The traditional value of marketing is that a firm makes something and then it sells it. It says, in this view, marketing takes place in the second half of the process. Companies that subscribe to this view have the best chance of succeeding in economics marked by goods shortages, where consumers are not fussy about quality, features, or style. For example, basic staple goods in developing markets. This traditional view of the business process, however, would not work in economies where people face abundant choices. So we have, so they're talking about the value delivery process. So in other words, you probably need a strategy of how you're going to deliver value to your customers. How you going to deliver value to your customers? How will the customers get value out of your products and services? So that is a strategy you have to come up with. So that probably will be the manager's job. Come up with a strategy of how they're going to implement strategy, how they're going to provide strategy to the customers. So in other words, you cutting hair, you curling hair, your barbershop, your hair salon, how you want to provide or implement value to your customers. So probably in the hair. When you cut hair, you curl hair, you want them to look like a new person. You want to look like a different person. I guess I would say a beautiful person. You want to look different than when you want to look different. You don't want to look the same as when they came in. You put it this way: when they leave, you want them to look different. You know, in other words, you want to be able to see. You want them to be able to see that they look different. You know, so they came. You came in looking like this, and you're going out looking like that. So that's value. So you have the value chain. They have a company called Cisco Systems Incorporated. All those Cisco systems, all those Cisco systems continue to grow. It's not growing at the breakneck speed of the 1990s. So its supply base needs have changed. The company has reduced its number of suppliers and aligned itself more closely with the remaining suppliers for each of its products-based teams. So that is Cisco. Value chain is a tool for identifying ways to create more customer value. It's a tool for identifying ways to create more customer value. So you have your value chain. So how you want to create ways, it's a tool to help them create more customer value. So you have to, I would say, that will come under continuous improvement as well. Because I would think that a company will have to continuously improve their value chain to keep on finding new ways to bring value to the customer. So I would think there would be a continuous process. So then they're talking about Netflix, and this is 1997. Back in 1997, Netflix, while most people were still fumbling with programming their VCRs, Netflix founder Reed Hastings became convinced that DVDs were the home video medium of the future. So DVDs, yes, they're still using DVDs, I guess. Because they, you know, what's those other tapes that they used to use? They don't use those no more. He raised $120 million, attracted hundreds of thousands of customers for his online movie DVD rental business. In terms of company public in 2002, gaining another 90 million. Netflix has distinctive capabilities that promise to keep the company on top, even as competitors such as Blockbuster and Walmart try to muscle in on its turf. A lot of competitors will come in and try to do the same thing you're doing. So they're talking about Walmart, Blockbuster. Walmart, Blockbuster. Who was that? Netflix, Walmart, Blockbuster, and Blockbuster. Blockbuster, I think they out of business now. These distinctive capabilities are no more late fees, overnight delivery, and a deep catalog of over 65,000 movie titles linked to systematic proprietary search software that allows customers to easily search for obscure films and discover new ones. I used to go to Blockbuster. I think I never need it right here. But so you see how companies were trying to come in and do something different than that's what I was saying when I was talking about keeping up with the competitors. You find out, you do some benchmarking. So you see, you try to find out what other companies are doing so you can do something better. You can offer a different service or lower price for the same product that they are selling or services they selling. Or they, you know, so they say Blockbuster, Netflix, and who else was there? Oh, that was Walmart, Blockbuster, and Netflix. So it says Blockbuster and Walmart. And I said, these distinctive capabilities are no late fees. So I'm trying to see who that was. Oh, Netflix has distinctive capabilities and promise to keep the company on top as even competitive. Okay, so there was Netflix. Netflix came in and they said they offered some services where they were not charging no late fees. So they had overnight delivery. And they had a deep catalog of 65,000 movie titles. So in other words, they were doing things that Blockbuster and Walmart were not doing. So no late fees. So this was Netflix. But this was 1997. But so still, the concept is still the same. You always want to do things better, different, conveniently, at a lower price. You want to offer services that the other company is not offering, so you can pull those customers in. So in other words, no late fees, overnight deliveries, different things that Netflix were offering. Walmart, and Blockbuster were not offering, so they figure I can bring some kind of foreign customers in to me. So that's good when you benchmark, because how would Netflix have known that Blockbuster and Walmart were not offering those same incentives that they were offering if they didn't do no benchmarking? And they had to do some benchmarking to see what Blockbuster and Walmart were offering. So Netflix said, we're going to say, look, no late fees, we have overnight deliveries, and we're going to keep y'all coming back. We're going to keep y'all coming back to us. So, thank you for joining me today. And so, I'm Cheryllee from the Everything Cheryllee brand. And see, sometimes they only put no good songs on here. So sometimes you have to pick up yourself. But I like my music to keep on flowing. So I just want to say thank you for joining me today. And so this is the Cheryl Hubbard Show, but I am Everything Cheryllee. So I also had these t-shirts. I had these made up for my brand, Everything Cheryllee brand. And also, I will probably be setting up a website shortly. All right, let me get a little drink. Sometimes you do a lot of talking, your mouth is a little dry. Good. So, I want to say thanks for joining me, but I just want to mention a couple of things. So shortly, I will be setting up my website. So I'm still marketing my Cheryllee Cosmetic brand. So sometimes it's hard to get the picture. There you go. But so I have my label. This is my label, but I have my logo and my picture. So that's I have hair growth product for men, women, women and children. And they will go out of these boxes, but I'll probably be setting up a website shortly. So these are just my thank you cards. And so orders will go out in boxes like these. And I'll, you know, put some of these in there, and then, you know, they come in jars like this. And for what I do, I use all natural products, ingredients rather. So for my products, so this is raw mango butter, African shea butter, and then also my raw coconut butter. More cocoa butter. So everything would be melted down, and then they go in my jars. And so I have my oils that I do use, sweet almond. Sweet almond, black castor oil. When I'm making my hair growth products, I have a hair growth product for men, women, and children. So it'll be a balm in the jar. And then I have a grape seed oil that I use. Avocado oil. Regular castor oil. There's another Jamaican black castor oil. And I will use beeswax. And this is cocoa butter. And then that's some jojoba oil. And I also put some essential oils, lemongrass. So all my products I make with natural essential oils. When I said coconut butter, raw mango butter, raw shea butter, Jamaican black castor oil, grape seed oil. So the box that I have, brand new jars, so when I make them, I'll put my labels on.
So it'll be labels just like these. So I have, you know, labels like these. So my Cheryllee Cosmetics brand, and I have my Everything Cheryllee brand. Everything Cheryllee brand, which would be my t-shirts, sweatshirts, you know, different items that I would have under my Everything Cheryllee brand. But I want to say thanks for joining me today, and you know, this was very interesting reading from my marketing book. So I'll be going through that book. I'm just at the beginning of the book. Just at the beginning of the book, so I'll be bringing information. Yeah, so like I said, these are the oils that I will be using, sweet almond oil, all natural oils for all my products. And so I'm an hour and 20 minutes, so I want to say thanks for joining me. And also, I'm doing these too. These are the Cheryllee Cosmetics brand, so I'll be offering these too on my website. And then the other ones. Just regular tablets, so you know you want to take notes for your business. And this is, so when you, you're buying your inventory, I'll buy this shredded, you know, to put inside. Put inside your boxes. It's inside your boxes, so I have a whole stack of these, but they don't come like this. You put them together yourself. So I want to say thanks for joining me today, and I did enjoy the session. Thanks for joining me today, and I hope you see you on my next video. So if you have any questions, you have any ideas, anything that you might want me to talk about, just let me know. You know, comment below, subscribe below. I'm trying to get my subscribers up. So, subscribe below, like my video, subscribe below, comment below, let me know anything you think that, you know, anything you think that I should talk about that is, you know, interesting, educational, and like good for the public. I'll be ready to talk about things. So also, if you have any products you want me to review, or you want me to show on my channel, show it to the public on my channel, I'll be ready to comment below, subscribe below. I am Everything Cheryllee. I am Cheryl from Everything Cheryllee brand. And so this is the Cheryl Hubbard Show. Also, like on my other video on my phone with me, I'm going to show you my TikTok. I have a nice, smooth TikTok game. I'm gonna go. So I like to play a lot, but you know, thanks for joining me. So subscribe below, comment below, please come on. Subscribe, let me get my, help me get my subscribers up. I think I got a low amount of subscribers, but let me know what music you might want to hear while I'm, you know, any topic that you might want to talk about, or any terms that you might want me to explain. So like I said, marketing, advertising, promoting, talking markets, marketing channels, competitive advantages, your competitive advantage strategy. How you gonna deal with your competitors? You have to build a strategy for that. So, and then getting down deep in the surface, total quality management, continuous improvement, benchmarking, a management strategy, customer strategy. You know, how are you going to pull in those customers? You need a strategy for that too. But I want to say thanks for joining me. I don't want to take this video all the way over to 2 hours. It already is about an hour. So I see y'all next time on my video.
Somebody's birthday tonight, somewhere. And I know somebody's gonna celebrate.
He said, "No, somebody's birthday tonight, somewhere." They out there with all the motorcycles. So any products you want me to review, please, I will do it gladly. I will gladly do it. So just let me know, you know, subscribe below, comment below. Any terms you want me to explain, look up, you should research on. So, I think I did enough dancing, but so comment below, subscribe below, and so, well, one more thing, you know, if you want to run your business, you want to start a business, you do. If you're not interested, or if you're not sure that things are going to take off the way you want them to take off, you know why that? Register with Amazon, Etsy, eBay, you can sell right there. You know, create your business name, sell your products right there. Build your customer base, build your target market right there. And then see if that is for you before you go out and get your business license and storefront. But you can also open up, some people have opened up like a boutique online, t-shirt businesses online, everything is online now. But if you want to venture out and get your business license, if you're dealing in food, or you're dealing in the industry that, you know, you definitely need that license right away, then do it, you know. So thank you for joining me, and I will see you on my next video. So you all have a good one, and I'll see you on my next video. Take care.